के साजो पकड़ रहा हूं इस बात
Honorable Chief Minister of Rajasthan, Secretary General Mr. Mishra, Honorable Parliamentarians and Delegates who have joined this forum meeting. Since yesterday and this morning, we have been deliberating on the importance of the development goals, their relevance, the challenges we face, and the means and ways in which we can achieve these goals. And we have all benefited from the experiences that have been shared here. As women parliamentarians, we have an equal role to play. And if I may say, part to transformational change by bringing about sustainable development policies and legislation that can help our countries achieve the SDGs. As BRICS, we are an association which is uniquely placed to significantly influence growth and development through meaningful partnerships. May I now request Srimati Poonam Mahajanji, Member of Parliament, Mumbai, to present the declaration before this August assembly. As we come close to end of this thought-provoking conference, I thank all the BRICS stakeholders who made this declaration a really a smooth ride. It just was a 40-minute meeting and we all agreed upon every forum on women parliamentary enablers for achieving SDGs, Jaipur, 20 to 21st August. We, the women parliamentarians from Federative Republic of Brazil, the Russian Federation, the Republic of India, the People's Republic of China and the Republic of South Africa, having assembled at this meeting of the BRICS Women Parliamentarian Forum on the theme Women Parliamentarians Enabler for Achieving SDGs on 20 to 21st August 2006. Now, I read the declaration. Recognizing that the meeting bears utmost relevance as we strive towards achieving in Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs by 2030. Strongly believing that the SDGs and the associated targets do constitute a comprehensive plan towards achieving meaningful growth and progress and will stimulate action in areas of critical importance involving people, planet, prosperity, peace and partnership. Reaffirming the UFA declaration adopted during the 7th BRICS Summit on July 9, 2015, that there has to be an integrative approach to implement the post-2015 development agenda. Stressing that the countries need to production. Welcoming the Addis Ababa action agenda that stresses financing for development and transfer of technology to and capacity building measures in the developing and least developed countries on favorable terms. Bearing in mind that BRICS parliamentarians, especially women parliamentarians, are well placed to promote the transformation agenda of SDGs in providing a legislative framework in formulating people-centric development policies and in implementing and monitoring the progress in achieving SDGs. Acknowledging that the informed deliberations on the theme of the meeting Women Parliamentarians Enabler for Achieving SDGs have helped to frame, crystallize and contextualize issues that are an integral and indispensable elements of SDGs. Do hereby express commitment to intensify mutual cooperation based on the framework and associated action plan agreed upon and reaffirmed at the BRICS first BRICS Parliamentary Forum held in Moscow in 2015 and to strengthen their strategic partnership on all the three dimensions of sustainable development, which is economic growth, social inclusion and environmental protection. Call upon international financial institutions to support and facilitate financing for development on favorable terms for the developing and the least developed countries and to help them gain easier access to new and affordable technologies for capacity building and research under the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change and the Paris Agreement. Underscore the need to address climate change in all its manifestations and work out integrated solutions to preserve and protect ecological systems and forests and ensure food security. Underlying the significance of expeditious parliamentary approval of SDG-related legislation and adequate budgetary resources, oversight and monitoring of implementation through procedural devices and parliamentary committees. Stress to need to engender all legislative and development plans for incorporating gender concerns into the process and procedures to contribute more rigorously to robust legislation and policy making to coordinate their efficient implementations. Reiterate the imperative of greater involvement of women parliamentarians in integrating citizens as stakeholders in processes of development to create ownership of the SDGs and their pivotal role in providing leadership to and mentoring of elected women representatives at the grassroots so they can be agent of change in achieving SDGs. Call for equality, inclusivity, and call for equity, inclusivity, and sustainability to be factored into all development plans. Commit to work tirelessly to ensure that society progresses in a manner that accommodates the needs of today's world without endangering the capacity of coming generations to meet their future requirements. Emphasize the need to inform, communicate, and educate citizens about developmental schemes and strive to ensure effective utilization of funds and effective service delivery mechanisms. Further emphasize the need to institutionalize the BRICS Women Parliamentarians Forum to become an integral component as enablers of achieving SDGs and similar issues of mutual interest to BRICS member states. Resolve to encourage the BRICS Women Parliamentarians to strive towards both broad-based, resilient, inclusive and credible community-driven sustainable BRICS development as a means to achieve the sustainable development goals. I do hereby propose the Jaipur Declaration for adoption by this August Council. We now take it that the Jaipur Declaration has been adopted unanimously. I will request the delegates to support the letter. Please get started with the team.
Мы принимаем это сердце и искренне признательны организационному
The Honourable Speaker of the Lok Sabha, Madam Sumitra Mahajanji, the Honourable Chairperson of the National Council of Provinces of South Africa, Mrs. T.R. Modise, the Honourable Deputy Chairperson of the Council of Federation of Russia, Mrs. Galina Karalova, Mr. Anup Mishra, the Secretary General, distinguished women parliamentarians from the BRICS nations, ladies and gentlemen, very, very good morning to you. And I take this opportunity to welcome you all to the big city of Jaipur. It's been a great pleasure to have the opportunity to have hosted you all over the last day and a half. And I do hope that you're all going to go back with wonderful memories, not just of your stay here, but of the work that you've done with the Jaipur Declaration. I want to thank from the bottom of my heart, Madam Speaker, for having given us this opportunity. I must tell you at the outset that I've had the privilege and the honour of having worked with her over many, many years in Parliament. After the first 5 terms we were together, but then I came back to the States. She continues to work and leave her stamp on the country as Speaker of the Parliament. It's a great privilege. And it is only appropriate that she should be heading this very, very interesting meeting that is happening in the AGs of the BRICS here in Rajasthan. And thank you very much, Sumitra ji, for allowing this to happen here, to have chosen Rajasthan. And I hope that we have lived up to your expectations. In fact, I'm sure we have. And I look forward for you all that one and a half day that is left, that you will enjoy this after the closing of this meeting, the rest of your stay here in Rajasthan. So the theme of this forum today is women's parliamentarians and enablers for achieving the SDGs. It's not just contemporary man, but it also carries with it a great deal of the gravity and the importance of the SDGs. Parliaments are basically the ultimate law-making bodies of all of our countries. And it is a very, very important institution in the lives of the people of that area. So if you look at it in that background, the role of the parliamentarians is extremely vital. So today, we as lawmakers, whether we are daughters, whether we are mothers, and of course we are sisters, not only do we represent the people, but we also guide administration, and we also bring to the table a different outlook, which is of compassion and caring. I think that's very important, because ruling is not about using one brain. Of course, that's important. It's also about compassion and caring. It's also about having a heart. If the two come together, I believe that it creates an atmosphere where things can get done quickly. It enables us to be better guardians of the processes that lead to actually improving the quality of life of the people that we are either representing or leading. So none of the people gathered here today are strangers to the needs of the development in our respective countries. And all of us from the BRICS countries, because they tell me that it's 43% of the population. So, irrespective of the differences in the development indices and growth levels, all members of the BRICS have large populations that actually require nurturing, caring, and support. And of course, we need very much support. So to achieve this end, it is important that we involve ourselves with these development processes, which are finally sustainable. So since the Earth Summit in Rio, 1992, the concept of this so-called sustainable development has been refined over a period of time and has now become a very integral part of what they call the development management the world over. Its verticals are processes that are rights-based, equitable, inclusive, which lead to sustainability at the local, the regional, the national, and therefore the global level. None of this can happen if we are not, at the lowest level of government, able to put this into practice. So, today, notwithstanding all the different ideologies that we all have and all the different approaches to development that we have, I'm sure that there is absolutely no dispute amongst us about the fact that poverty has to end. I think we all agree on this. That not just poverty has to end, it has to include within that improvements in delivery of food to other people, health, education, and of course gender equality. Because in most of these countries, women are still fighting breakthrough the last year. And therefore, apart from all of this, importance has to be given to things like sustainability in the management of water, this is the everyday business, energy, industry, and all of this is vital to our growth and our development in each of our countries. So I'm sure that we will all agree that we need to make our cities definitely safer and definitely more resilient, modify our consumption patterns so that they are sustainable and that they work together to preserve natural resources and ecosystems. And last but not the least, we really need to be able to work together to bring down the inequalities among the nations so that we can all coexist peacefully. But the problems all arise here. It's all about being able to give a large chunk of all of this to all of our people. These then are the SDGs. So, we, the member nations of BRICS, together represent a huge majority of the peoples of the world and naturally of the production too. Regional imbalances in resource distribution, in climate, and naturally development indices are features which are common to us all. Our people all share a similar aspiration. Our development challenges are pretty close, I would say similar. And if we are to secure the future of our citizens, then it becomes extremely imperative for all of us that we cooperate, that we learn from each other. And the lessons that we learn, we share those best practices with each other and strengthen this block so that we can present a united front before the world and actually create an example for them whereby we show that we are able to do so many of these things together. The world is a divided place, and 43% of the humanity of this country, of this world, can actually get together. Imagine the kind of changes we will be able to do. If we can. Therefore, Mr. Obama's words always ringing my mind when he said, if you think of these countries, you always think, we're at the bottom of the heap, can we do this? But we have countries who have shown how they have jumped to the forefront. And therefore, when he says, yes, we can, it's just about actually believing in it yourself. Because if you believe in what you do, and you believe in it passionately, it comes true. I'm not saying that it's something to do with the esoteric, but it's definitely a lot of hard work brought together with a lot of strong belief, with a lot of passion, in understanding that our people need to make that break. And it's time now that this group of people was able to find its place in the Committee of Nations. So, BRICS can play that catalytic role in forging that partnership amongst women lawmakers in mainstreaming these SDGs across the policy-making universe. It is something that everybody wants to do. So why can we not, by coming together, create a platform which enables us to be at the forefront of the new changes that are going to take place in the world today. So in India, we have examples which reflect our intent and our faith. Today, our Lok Sabha or the House of the People is chaired by a lady. Our External Affairs Minister is also a lady. Three of our large and popular states have women chief ministers. But there are few strides we need to make. I always say that women cannot be kept down at the level of tourism or at the rate of the level of women and child development. The time has come to reach out to defense. The time has come to reach out towards finance. These are all common sensical things, and women are extremely common sensical. We run our pass that on to all the gentlemen. We run our homes using common sense and strength. This is just a larger family, and it's about applicability. If we are able to apply the same principle to the running of the nation, running of the country, running of the state, running of those people in the area that you represent, it makes all the difference. And I'm sure it can be done. So, reaching out, and here are examples that teach us that we can reach out to make that difference. Our democratic traditions are established. We believe that education is hugely important. It can only bring about the change if you have no education. We do not educate our people, there is no way that we are going to be able to make that leap forward. So, in Rajasthan, we have made educational qualifications mandatory for representatives elected to local governments today. I mean, what is within our process? For years together, people remained where they were, and we were given the theory that there is a wisdom in the manner of, you know, in which people rule, it comes through the ages. I don't know, how about a little bit of education? And the young people said thank you very much because we would never have got an opportunity otherwise. Now we have the opportunity of being able to step up because we have the education behind us. And because of that education, women have also been able to make their mark. So we said to them, at that level, a certain amount of education is absolutely important. And 50% of women must make the grade. I remember very clearly at that time, because you know, I don't know whether it probably doesn't happen in many of the other countries, but we are a very civil society. And in our society, women cover their faces, they don't go out before large gatherings to meet men, and even within the family, they pull the veil before certain members. So I remember when we came with this new proposal, people said to us, why are you bothering with these women? They're all behind the veil, number one. Number two, we will do the work. We will do the work. And they'll only have to sign. So I said, that's absolutely fine, but we need to make the change. So we made the change, and I must tell you that within a very short time, these gentlemen have learned how to support the home fires, whereas the women were able to raise the veil, and not only did they raise the veil, they were able to shine, and not only did they shine, they did a great job. So today, 50% are capable women, and more have suddenly seen the light and decided that they could also do it. So it's given them an opportunity, which I think is very important. Therefore, education. Now it's hugely important because a large amount of money now is going down right to the bottom here in India. And people have to be receptive to be able to take that and apply it in the areas that they govern. And for them, therefore, education is hugely important. So these qualified representatives now become our torchbearers for the alleviation of poverty, eradication of hunger, health reforms, and environmental protection. The Niti Aayog, thanks to the Prime Minister, is a central government policy think tank that has been assigned today the role of overseeing the implementation of the SDGs by the various ministries of the Union Government. So there's a dedicated team of people that is working to evolve these indicators related to these 17 SDGs and 169 targets. So all the government programs today have been focused in such a manner that the fundamentals of development are now getting attended to. Now, Rajasthan is India's largest state. We are 10% of India's landmass, 6% of the population, and as large a state, almost France or Germany. So today, the central government's active support to what we are calling cooperative federalism is allowing us to formulate policies and schemes that allow us wings to deal with our own development requirements. The central schemes are objectives. These are mapped with our target groups, and they lead to effective and timely implementation of schemes that come up from the state government level. So us in Rajasthan, and it's amazing because it's very close to the SDG goals, our development model is actually based on a triad of social justice, effective governance, and job creation, and naturally, therefore, eco-improvement. So this is really basing itself on the SDGs. And in 2007, ours was the first state in the country to introduce financial inclusion. Now, in the world, financial inclusion is taken for granted. But in India, we're still taking steps towards actually rolling it out across the whole country. And I'm proud to say that in 2007, we brought this to the forefront of our program in Rajasthan. It was aimed at actually empowering the women, because this program was applied to families where women were, so we call, the heads of the family. We said these cards will go to, and the families will be registered under the name of the woman of the family. So she's the one who's going to be able to keep a tight rein on the financials of the family. And so it's very important that we empower her. So it was a two-in-one program. One, a direct benefit transfer, financial inclusion, and the empowerment of women through the use of the card and the financial inclusion too. Our efforts today in the state in financial inclusion ensure transfer of direct and indirect benefits without the fear of the wastage or the leakage or graft. And this is probably the first state in which almost all families, particularly in that particular range, have been included, and financials are already going directly to the bank. And not only that, you actually, you know, co-branded your RuPay cards and all that, you can actually use cash and non-cash. So if you go to a ration shop, for example, you can use your card, and when you go out, you get a message to say that you have so much ration left over. So there's no leakages. And if you use your, what they call the POS machines, if you use your impressions, yeah, then even then you can use, you can get this, because the cashless transfer, you can immediately draw it from a bank or from a ration shop. You're actually going to be able to utilize that. And I'm very happy to tell you, it's the only state in the country that's doing it. I of course, we started it a long time ago. There was a hiatus for 5 years. Now we've started again. And I'm very happy to tell you that there are no leakages and the people are benefiting from this. This scheme also serves as an identity. So you had the Aadhaar scheme in Government of India, which became the identity, but we have taken all of this out together. There are no separate cards. And what rides in this is also a health insurance, which is probably the highest in the country today. It ranges from 30,000 rupees to 3 lakhs rupees for very serious illnesses. And we have already got and developed the packages, and large amounts of money are going directly to it. So we have not only got free medicine for the poor people, but also, so 70% of our people are covered as far as health is concerned, and will continue to improve. So financially, and health-wise. And on this card, all government programs, pensions, birth of children in hospitals, all of this that gets paid for by government goes directly into the accounts of those women and their families. So it also serves as family and individual identity, and it creates a biometrically enabled database. So skill development and livelihood programs, again, was something we started in 2004 Today they are at a different level, not just in the country, but Rajasthan is the premier state. Many gold medals later, many citations later, Rajasthan is today the top state for skill development. And specially cited are our partnerships with private industries in skilling young people and women, which again is our strength here. Our partnerships so far have proved to be extremely effective in creating employment opportunities, not just for the youngsters, but for the ladies too. One of the founding fathers of our constitution, Mr. Ambedkar, said that I measure the progress of a community by the degree of progress which women have achieved, and we've applied that usually here in Rajasthan. So in order to tackle legacy shortcomings in development indices, we have a number of schemes which target the girl child, the adolescent girl, and women, and cater to their education, to their sanitation, and to their reproductive and child health needs. And we also have a very vibrant women's health care group movement. Being a dry state, water of course is a huge concern to all of us. And our water program, which we started last year on a very large scale, became a people's movement across this huge state, in which individuals, corporate houses, the uniformed services, that is army, the police and everyone else, civil society, religious heads of various Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs and Christians, all came together to rehabilitate what we call the traditional water and harvesting structures, and constructed new structures right across the state to the tune of almost 92,000, which happened in just 6 months. Over, we have 10,000 what they call gram panchayats or village headquarters in our state, and we have covered almost 4,000 of these now. We have had a very good monsoon, and if you look at the transformation that is taking place, it will make everyone very, very happy. This year, the movement will continue. The central government's emphasis on what they call the cooperative federalism has unleashed a certain amount of competition between states. They are now seeking to outperform each other, also create infrastructure and social development, but also sustainable partnerships leading to investments and job creation. Today, that these BRICS events are being held in different states is an example of how the government intends to expose our states to the world so that we may learn from each other. We just had a BRICS Smart City conference the other day. Now all of you are here. And tomorrow, the disaster management conference is starting in another city of Rajasthan, Udaipur, and I'm sure it will also be very successful. So the task before us today is cut out. We have a lot more to prove, and life is much more difficult because we have to go out to prove it. And I always say that if our counterparts have to work that much, we have to work that much more to prove ourselves. But I never see women complaining about that. I never hear them say, like, men go out to work in the morning at 9 o'clock and come back at 6 o'clock and say, I'm so tired, where's my tea, and having cooked something, and have my bath water ready, I'm exhausted. Women do that 24 hours. They see their men off in the morning with their breakfast, they see the kids off in the morning with their breakfast, they don't say, oh God, I'm really exhausted. They go out, work, come back, and when the poor fellow puts his feet up and says, oh, I'm so tired, they fuss around him, they organize his bath, they get him his food, and when they've done everything, including their work successfully, they turn in. And I never heard a complaint and say, God, it's a 24 hour job. So there is huge potential here that I think is really not comprehensive. And every time, because I have a huge male audience also while we're looking at this, I always tell them, be not threatened by us. We are not competitive, we are complementary. So if we work together complementarily, we would change the world, but please do allow us our position. Alongside, no more walking behind, now walking together to change the world. So the task before us is really cut out. We have to appreciate that these challenges are enormous, but human spirit and our resolve are capable of actually overcoming all these hurdles. And when we add cooperation and participation to the mix, we have, I believe, a recipe for success. No goal is unachievable. And I'm confident that we women leaders can and will very, very successfully address the task that is before us. I want to compliment everyone for today successfully negotiating the Jaipur Declaration. I'm sure that it will leave a mark for all those of us who have participated here today. I would like to just sign off with a bit of hope. And this I draw from a quote that I came across very recently. It says, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. But the second best time is now. So, let us all put our collective shoulder to the wheel to change the circumstances in the world. We haven't done it so far, but I believe that when we do it, it is going to make that huge difference that is going to be able to bridge the gap that no one's been able to bridge so far. I want to thank at the end of this Madam Speaker for having chosen again Jaipur, for these very, very important ladies from the BRICS that have been here with us today. Thank you, and all your support systems for being here with us today. I want to thank all the parliamentarian ladies and the so-called core group that actually went out to make this a huge success. Thank you, Poonam, that was so nicely conducted. And thank you very much, Sushmita, for making the moderation seem so comfortable and easy. How come we can do all these things so comfortably and so easily? How come we can make it look like it was not a conference, but it was a discussion between all of us? I want to thank you all for making this possible today. And come back, please, to Jaipur again and again. This is not a one-off relationship. This is a relationship that we have forged for keeps. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you
for your excellent and encouraging speech. I have no doubt that you only enriched us further. Now I request Honorable Speaker, Lok Sabha, to address the House. And I think it's appropriate to say that she's got all of us together here in Jaipur, which has taken a lot of effort, a lot of conviction. She has guided the core group through the arrangements, through the vision of this conference, of this summit. And I would like everybody to give her a big round of applause.
Another new journey
at the venue of the first ever meeting of the BRICS Women Parliamentarian Forum. It is a historic occasion as it brought together women parliamentarians from Asia, Europe, Africa and Latin America for the first time. It is certainly a great occasion for us to host the women parliamentarian from BRICS. Now, this meeting is the first meeting because now we have come closer to our heart from the developing perspective. This meeting is taking the Moscow initiative to a higher place now. Distinguished delegates, I strongly believe that dialogue among parliamentarians is important in deepening cooperation and promoting strategic partnership, especially in the context of Agenda 2030 and the Sustainable Development Goals. This event is conceived in the spirit. I am grateful to you all for coming here and participating in the deliberations of the agenda. Not only that, members of parliament are in a better position to interface between citizens and government, and also laws and legislations are instruments through which sustainable development can be brought about. We must learn and benefit from the best practices available in BRICS countries. Actually, that is important. I greatly appreciate your active participation and the valuable suggestions you have offered. I'm sure this will encourage us to meet regularly to discuss issues and exchange views in order to acquire deeper insights and develop a perspective on the problems and challenges faced by us as lawmakers to make our planet a better place to live. During the two-day deliberations, we discussed three important subjects, namely perspective on implementation of SDGs, achieving SDG role of women parliamentarians in involving citizens, and containing climate change, imperatives of global cooperation. The first subject bears great relevance in the context of our journey towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. I strongly believe the 17 goals and the 169 associated targets have the potential to transform the future of our country by accelerating our endeavors and to take us on the path of a meaningful growth. In close harmony with nature, it must be our endeavor to achieve these goals in our own interest and in global interest as well. As lawmakers, it is our responsibility to oversee and monitor the implementation strategies and mechanisms of the SDGs put in place by our respective governments. The second subject, achieving SDGs, role of women parliamentarians in involving citizens, is of great significance from the developmental perspective. Development must be inclusive. If it is to be equitable, sustainable and effective, therefore, mainstreaming equity is vital for ameliorating the socio-economic conditions of people within the framework of sustainable development. As women, we have a natural instinct towards development and progress. As rightly said by our Chief Minister Vasundhara Raje, we have that passion, we have that motherly instinct, and so that with that we can do much more. So, we are seen as agents of change. It is widely recognized that if there is money in a woman's hand, there is money in her house. If the woman's hand is strong, her family is strong. And if there is happiness on a woman's face, there is happiness in her home. As developing partners, we can involve citizens in the process of development and can also strengthen innovative partnerships with civil society organizations to scrutinize and assist the effectiveness of various government programs. Therefore, active involvement of our women parliamentarians in the process will result in a greater responsiveness towards citizens' needs and will lead to a greater harmony, meaningful development and inclusive growth. Another important subject covered during the meeting was strengthening climate change imperatives for global action. Climate change affects humanity as a whole, but at the same time, we as developing countries have our own challenges also. During the discussions, we came to know of several best practices that are followed in different countries, especially on women's welfare, and to encourage women's involvement in developmental schemes and policies. In Brazil, 5-minute programs are run on radio and television to promote women-oriented programs targeting specific social groups. In Russia, there is a special focus on preventive medical checkup and serious efforts to lower the incidence of non-communicable diseases. From our Chinese parliamentarians, we have come to know that they have a 4-point action plan. The action plan involves women's all-round development, protection of women's rights and interests, building harmonious and inclusive society, and fostering a global environment favorable for women's development in South Africa. The Select Committee and Portfolio Committee on Women in Parliament and its multi-party women caucus in both houses of parliament have been a major development. I note with satisfaction that this forum has highlighted the concerns shared by the BRICS countries on climate change and the ways and means to deal with it. Overall, the priority theme of the meeting and the session focused on the implementation areas and also highlighted the emphasis that member states are expected to put on SDGs. Let us join hands together to make implementation of SDGs a huge success, because I firmly believe that the best way to predict future is to create it. That will be, and we will do it, I'm quite sure, together. As we are closing the historic event on a memorable note, I express my sincere appreciation to all of you for your active and meaningful participation in the discussions during the informed sessions we have had over the past 2 days. I'm sure the valuable suggestions you have given and the experiences we all shared amongst us during the deliberations will be useful in further streamlining our development agenda. An event of this magnitude is made possible only with the involvement of many individuals and agencies. On behalf of all the disciplinary delegates and on my own behalf, I express my sincere gratitude to Honorable Chief Minister of Rajasthan, Srimati Vasundhara Raje, for sparing time from her busy schedule to join us in the meeting, and for the very, very insightful valedictory address. I can say that in valedictory, no doubt, as a head of state, but with that motherly instinct, that passion, whatever she is doing here, and really her address was very good guidance faculty, how all of us can learn. And that is also known that it is something made against women. What she says correctly is, we are complimenting. Whatever we are doing, we are also supporting, but supporting very strongly. for our nation. That is something. So I again thank you, thanks to her. We are thankful to the Honorable Chief Minister, the ministerial colleagues, and I can see Jyoti and Suman Sharma as well. Because two pairs, you are soldiers, like, as elected person. So thank you very much for that. And the government of Rajasthan also, our officers, other agencies, and for the whole country, cooperation, extension, facilitating a successful conclusion of the meeting. We are also grateful to Kailash Meghwalji, Speaker of Vidhan Sabha, Rajasthan, for this legislative assembly, for its utmost cooperation in making this event a grand success. I thank the Secretary of the Rajasthan Legislative Assembly and its dedicated team of officers and staff for the efficiency and commitment they have shown in organizing these meetings successfully. I thank all the women parliamentarians of this country, especially the chairpersons of various sessions and panelists and delegates who participated in this event. I am not thanking my core group because they will be with me in so many events we have to go again. And our core group will be the greater sound. They will be so all the delegates, panelists, and their valuable participation that will enrich the proceedings of this event. Our thanks are also to the Secretary General of Lok Sabha because yes, they are all my persons, but still, yes, they have worked hard and they will be doing hard work. So we mean. So, Ministry of Mishra Ji, Secretary Dr. D. Bhalla, and the officers and staff of the Lok Sabha Secretariat, you know, there are so many persons of Lok Sabha Secretariat. There are so many days, not only these people. All of these people, I give them thanks, wholehearted thanks. So I also take this opportunity to thank the ministries involved in this event, particularly Ministry of External Affairs, I should feel, for their cooperation and support. Before concluding, let us resolve to continue our endeavors towards achieving the SDGs and to promote these goals as a universal framework. Our commitment should be towards the implementation of the Jaipur Declaration. Now it's very good because being Vasundhara Raje as head of state and woman, and I can see under this Jaipur Declaration has come. So definitely all of us will work for that. I have no doubt that we will exceed the expectations going by the enthusiasm and involvement shown over the past 2 days. I wish you all a pleasant and safe journey back tomorrow, not today, because you are always coming back. Yes, yes. That's why I said tomorrow, not today. Because today we are having a very good dinner and not only dinner, we could come and I am just about to see that. So, pleasant stay today, I can say, and then safe journey back tomorrow. And I hope you will cherish beautiful memories of this meet and a thought, very good thought, again our Indian shloka is Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashchit Sukhapatvani, which means that may all live happily, may all enjoy good health, may all see auspiciously, may none experience distress, may peace prevail everywhere. And with this, I conclude and I'm really thankful to all of you. Thank you. Thank you.
here. You will all be going for lunch, and I am sure you will enjoy the afternoon shopping and sightseeing, hopefully. But this evening, 7 o'clock, I have a very, very interesting performance for you, which I hope that you will stay for. And after that, we will be having dinner, and I'm looking forward to seeing you all there.
Yes.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this thing does get over till tomorrow morning.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you all very much for being here, and I will hand you over to Sushita.
Thank you. I thank everybody who's, every officer of the Rajasthan government, our team who's come from Delhi, who has actively and relentlessly worked hard for this. I think we've all earned a good PM from the lobby, if anybody's interested. We'll also be at 6:30 PM. Delegates will depart for the hotel for the cultural program, which is organized by Raj.